So it was getting close to time where God was going to bring his people into the promised land. And then Moses was 120 years old, and God had already told him, you will not bring the people into the land because you did not believe me and you did not sanctify me in the sight of the children of Israel at the rock. And so God told Moses, it's about time for you to die. And he said, he told Moses what the people were going to do when they got in the promised land, and it was not going to be good. And then he said, write down the words of this song and teach it to them, that they will know it and it will be a witness against them when this happens. So God gave Moses a song, and he gave it to the Israelites. And so what kind of song do you think this is? Like a classical or a country or a gospel song?
Heavens and earth.
So it's a rock song. Well, it's all about the rock. And so so we're going to look at this song. We're going to divide it up into five sections. And we're going to see that it's a song that we should be singing today. So Mr. Eisman's going to start singing rock songs. So we're going to see that we should be singing it today and how it applies to us. So the first section of the song tells them who God is. So look at verse 3. He said, because I will publish the name of the Lord, ascribe ye greatness unto our God. So he says, I will proclaim the name of the Lord, attribute greatness to him. So give him glory, put the spotlight on him. So are we doing that today? If his name is mentioned in the world today, it's usually used in vain.
Right.
And so this first section tells us who God is. So who is he? Look at verse 4. It says, he is the rock. He is firm. He is faithful. The Israelites could always count on him. When they were hungry, he gave them manna. When they were thirsty at the waters of Marah, they were bitter. He made them sweet. He is always faithful to keep his word and his promises. He does not change. He said, I am the Lord. I change not. And it says, his work is perfect. So when he made the whole world, he looked back and he saw that, behold, everything, it was very good. So everything he's ever done, everything he's doing, and everything he will do is perfect. So people today might look around the world and say, well, God's not doing anything. But he is. God is always working, and his work is perfect. The best of our works are imperfect. It's going to have a scratch or a dent or a flaw, or we might not even finish it. But God always finishes his work, and it is perfect. This is all his ways are judgment, a God of truth. We looked last week. God is not a man that he should lie. And without iniquity, just and right is he. So he is the rock. So who is our rock? Jesus. So our rock is Jesus. Jesus is the stone that in Nebuchadnezzar's dream of the image, the stone made without hands came down and crushed the feet, and the whole image fell to pieces. And then that stone became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. He is the stone which the builders refused and has now become the chief cornerstone. He is the stumbling stone. He was the stumbling stone to the Jews and the rock of offense. And he is the spiritual rock that the Israelites drank from. So he is our rock. So are we proclaiming his name today? Are we proclaiming the name of Jesus and attributing greatness to his name? Peter did. So on the day of Pentecost, Peter stood boldly to the Jews, and he said, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom you crucified both Lord and Christ. So Peter was bold. He proclaimed the name of Jesus. In the second section, Moses tells them what God has done for you. So look at verse 6. It says, do ye thus requite the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? Is not he thy father that hath bought thee? Hath he not made thee and established thee? So he made them, he established them as a nation. He bought them out of slavery in Egypt. And he redeemed them with an outstretched arm. In verse 10, he found him in a desert land and in the waste howling wilderness. He led him about. God led the Israelites through the wilderness. He instructed him. He gave them the law. He kept him as the apple of his eye. So these people were so precious to God. He called them his peculiar treasure. He loved them. And that is just the same way with us. He made us. He bought us out of the bondage of sin with his precious blood. And now we are his peculiar people, his chosen generation, the Bible tells us. He loves us. And so we need to tell people what God has done for us. So there was a man in the Bible named Legion, and he wanted to follow Jesus, but Jesus said, no, I want you to go home and tell your friends all the great things the Lord has done for you. So Legion went out in Decapolis, and he told everyone. He said, I was possessed with many unclean spirits. I lived in the tombs. People tried to bind me with chains, but I would just break them. Day and night, I was in the mountains, crying out, cutting myself with stones. But then one day, I met a man named Jesus, and look at me now. He changed everything. So that's what we need to do, is tell everyone what he has done for us. Then the third section of the song tells them what you will do to God. So God knew what they were going to do, and he tells them beforehand in this song, when they get into the land, this is what you're going to do. So look at verse 15. It says, but Jeshurun, which is another name for Israel, waxed fat. So when they got into the land flowing with milk and honey, they were eating whatever they wanted. They had everything they wanted, and they grew fat. And it says, and they kicked, so they also grew proud. They were waxing fat, they were grown thick, they were covered with fatness, so they were in the promised land living it up. Then it says, then he forsook God which made him. So then they would forsake God and turn to those other gods. And it said, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. So there's the rock again. The rock of his salvation. So they just counted him as not important. They lightly esteemed him. So Jesus is the rock of our salvation. So just like when the Israelites were thirsty, God told Moses to take his rod, smite the rock in Horeb, and water came out. And the Bible says that that rock was Christ. So Jesus, he hung on the cross, he gave up the ghost, they came and pierced his side with a spear, and it said blood and water came out. So he is the rock of our salvation. He gave us salvation, and we can always stand on him to keep us. He'll never leave us or forsake us or let us go. And so do we lightly esteem him, or do we hold him as the most important thing in our life? Because that's what he is. Then look at 16 through 18. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful. You don't even think about him. And hast forgotten God that formed thee. So another mention of the rock that begat thee. So they came from him, and so do we. He formed us. And so are we unmindful of him, or do we acknowledge him? Do we talk to him every day? Do we tell him we love him? Do we praise him? Do we thank him? And how could we forget him? It says they forgot about God. How could we forget him? And the way we forget God is when we love the things of the world and serve the flesh. Then that's when we forget God. And so when you're talking to people, witnessing to them, they may say, I'm too mean to be saved. God will never save me. Well, you can tell him what you have done to God. You can tell him how you are a sinner. Like Paul, he said, I verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. He said, that I did. In Jerusalem, he said, many of the saints I shut up in prison. When they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. I compelled them to blaspheme. He said, I was exceedingly mad against them. I persecuted them to strange cities. He said, I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, injurious, and the chief of sinners. So he told what he had done to God. Then the next section of the song tells them what God will do to you. And so God said, this is going to testify against them. So when this happens, they can't say, why is this happening? Because they can think back to their song and know God told them, he warned them, this is why it's happening. So look at verse 20. He said, and I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very froward generation, children in whom is no faith. So God's presence had been with them, but now he said, I'll hide my face from them. They had turned their backs on him. Now he was going to turn his back on them. So he brought them out of Egypt. He fought for them. He drowned Pharaoh, the Egyptians, and all their chariots in the Red Sea. He defeated the Amorites, the Amalekites. He tore down the walls of Jericho for them. He gave them a land they didn't work for. He gave them vineyards that they didn't plant. He gave them cities they didn't build. But then they would turn their back on him, forsake him, and worship the false gods of other nations. So now what he was going to do was fight against them. Look at what he said, verse 23 through 25. He said, I will heap mischiefs upon them. I will spend mine arrows upon them. They shall be burnt with hunger and devoured with burning heat and with bitter destruction. I will also send the teeth of beasts upon them with the poison of serpents of the dust. The sword without and terror within shall destroy both the young man and the virgin, the suckling also with the man of gray hairs. But he doesn't want to do this. Look at verse 29. It says, oh, that they were wise, that they understood this, that they would consider their latter end. He loved these people, and he only wanted what was good for them. He didn't want them to disobey him. He just wanted to bless them, but they wouldn't let him. Just like a lot of times, all he wants to do for us is bless us and be good to us, but a lot of times we just won't let him. We put ourselves out of the position to receive what he has for us. Look at verse 30. How should one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight, except their rock had sold them and the Lord had shut them up? So fourth mention, their rock. So God was going to use the other nations in the land to punish them. He was going to use them to fight against the Israelites. And it says one of them, just one person, like one Canaanite or one person from another nation, would chase 1,000 Israelites. Two would put 10,000 to flight. But those other nations were weak compared to Israel because they didn't have the one true God. So how could they do this? It's because their rock had sold them. So they had sold God out for the idols of other nations, and now he was going to sell them out to the other nations. So our rock, Jesus, don't sell him out for the idols of this world. Like the song Dale sang last night, you can have all of this world, but give me Jesus. And then 31, for their rock is not as our rock, even our enemies themselves being judges. So our rock. So the only explanation as to why these other nations could defeat the Israelites is because their rock had sold them, because their rock, the ones they worshipped, were fake gods. He's not as our rock. So he isn't some god made by man's hands of wood and stone, but he is the great I am, the self-existing God that has always been and always will be. And he isn't some idol that can't see or hear, but the Bible says his eyes run to and fro throughout the whole earth. His hand isn't shortened that he cannot save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. So they were all false gods, but he is the one true living God. He doesn't dwell in temples made with hands, but he said, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. So Jesus, our rock, is so much better than anything in this world. So money, TV shows, social media, cars, boats, sports, things in the world, they can all be good things, but they cannot give you joy, they cannot give you love, they cannot fill the emptiness in your heart, and they cannot take you to heaven. Only Jesus can. And so sometimes, you know, what God will do to you, sometimes God has to whip us. He said, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. So when we turn from him, he gets our attention and he gets us back in line. But he does it because he loves us, and that's why he did it to Israel. And David, he talked about a time when God had to whip him. He said, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. And moving on to the last section of the song, and this is the good part, what God will do for you. So look at verse 36. He said, for the Lord shall judge his people and repent himself, there's our word, for his servants, when he seeth that their power is gone and there is none shut up or left. So because God is holy, righteous, and just, and he cannot change who he is, he must punish sin. So he turned away from them and he fought against them. But after he punished them, because God is love, because he loved them, and because he is also gracious and merciful, he was going to take a changed position toward them and fight for them. So he would repent himself. He would take a change position back for them and fight for them. Look at what he said, 37. He said, he shall say, where are their gods, their rock in whom they trusted, which did eat the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offerings? Let them rise up and help you and be your protection. So he's telling the Israelites, the gods you trusted, why aren't they helping you? Call out to them for them to help you. And look at 39. He says, see now that I am he, and there is no God with me. I kill and I make alive, I wound and I heal, neither is there any that can deliver out of my hand. For I lift up my hand to heaven and say, I live forever. So that's awesome. He said, if I wet my glittering sword and my hand take hold on judgment, I will render vengeance to mine enemies and will reward them that hate me. I will make mine arrows drunk with blood, my sword shall devour flesh, and that with the blood of the slain and of the captives, from the beginning of revenges upon the enemy. So then God was going to whip those other nations that was fighting against the Israelites. He said, rejoice, O ye nations, with his people, for he will avenge the blood of his servants and will render vengeance to his adversaries and will be merciful unto his land and to his people. So after all they had done against God, God was going to turn back to them and he was going to be for them again. So we need to tell people what God will do for you. So Paul, he traveled all over the world telling people what God will do for you. He told the Philippian jailer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and your house. So after Moses told them the words of this song, 46 and 47, he says, set your hearts unto the words which I testify among you this day. So set your hearts on these words. Verse 47, he said, it is not a vain thing for you, because it is your life. These words are your life. Do it and you will live. You will prolong your days in the promised land. So this right here, our word, or God's word, is our life. If we accept it, we live, receive everlasting life. If you reject it, die, receive everlasting punishment. And then after we're saved, if we live by it and obey it, we live a life of blessings. If we disregard it and disobey it, we live really a life of misery, missing out on all the blessings God has for us. And so that's what we need to do. We need to tell others about Jesus. Tell them who he is. He is the perfect Son of God. What he has done, he laid aside his glory in heaven. He put on humanity and he stepped down to this earth just to be beaten and whipped and spit upon and mocked and just to go to the cross and there die for your sins. And tell them about how he, even though you might have sinned against God, he still loves you. And he's up there at the right hand of God, make an intercession for you, and if you will just turn to him, he will turn to you. He'll put his arms around you and save you. He'll open your eyes, bring you out of darkness into the light. He'll take out the old stony heart and put in a heart of flesh. And the Bible says he will put a new song in my mouth. And so this is the new song we should be singing today, the rock song, telling others about Jesus.